Good morning. I am Jerry Rao. I'm the Assistant Chief in DEFA, responsible for leading the Office of Financial Assistance. And I'd like to welcome everybody that is participating in the webinar this morning. As many of you know, the Division of Environmental and Financial Assistance is reorganized into three offices. And as part of that reorganization, we plan to make greater use of tools like these webinars to help spread the word about some of our division's assistance opportunities. So the title of today's webinar is Addressing Harmful Algal Blooms and Reducing Nutrients in Wastewater, Community Loan Discounts and Grant Money for Equipment. So I'd like to provide a brief background and then introduce our speakers for today. So, by way of background, last August, in response to concerns regarding harmful algal blooms and their effect on drinking water systems, Ohio EPA proposed a multifaceted approach for the identification of toxins in finished water supplies and the treatment of these harmful toxins and the reduction of pollutants that cause these algal blooms. At that time, the agency announced three funding opportunities that would be available, two involving loans from Ohio State Revolving Funds and one involving a relatively small-scale grant program. So specifically, we announced that the Water Pollution Control Loan Fund, which is Ohio's wastewater state revolving fund, would make an additional $100 million available at a 0% interest rate for projects that included equipment or facilities to reduce the level of phosphorus and other pollutants. These funds were essentially targeted for improvements at publicly owned wastewater treatment plants. John Bernstein will talk more about this in just a few moments. The second feature is that the Drinking Water Assistance Fund, specifically the Water Supply Revolving Loan Account, or WSRLA, which is Ohio's drinking water state revolving fund, would make an additional $50 million available at a 0% interest rate for projects that included increased treatment at water treatment plants to treat for toxins produced from the harmful algal blooms, and other avoidance strategies, such as interconnections with other water supplies, elevated storage facilities, and alternative sources for source water. Susan Schell will talk more about this feature. And then third, a grant program was created to provide funds for the quick and cost-effective means to test source and finish water for the presence of cyanotoxins. Ohio EPA initially indicated that we'd make grants up to $10,000 for surface water, public water systems to purchase test kits and equipment. Susan will talk more about this program as well and has some program updates for the upcoming program year. So with that, I'd like to introduce our speakers for this morning. First up will be John Bernstein, who is the Engineering Unit Supervisor in the Office of Financial Assistance. And John will be followed by Susan Schell, who is the manager of the Operations and Financial Assistance section in the Division of Drinking and Groundwater. So, John, if you'd like to get us underway.
Thanks, Jerry. A lot of you are probably familiar with the WPCLF program. We offer low-interest loans for design, planning, and construction of wastewater infrastructure. That includes projects at wastewater treatment plants as well as within the collection system. We administer the program for the entire state out of Columbus. And the portion I'll be talking to you about is the nutrient reduction discount, which we also refer to as the NRD, and that's specifically for the WPCLF program. We have this year in 2015 $100 million in low-interest loans available for projects that reduce wastewater nutrient discharges from treatment plants. Currently, the projects that are eligible are strictly at the treatment plants, and collection system projects are not eligible. We expect that $100 million in additional 0% interest funds will be available in 2016, so we would welcome any suggestions you have in projects you'd like to see next year. And we do look at each project on a case-by-case basis, so we'll work with the applicant, let them know what the eligible portions of the project are. Project nominations can be submitted throughout the calendar year for planning, design, and construction loans. That's a little bit different than the typical WPCLF process. where we only accept nominations once a year. So these are only submitted online, and we've got the email address that those can be submitted to. The NRD addendum, which is to be submitted for all NRD projects, is also available on our website. For planning loans, if the project description supports the conclusion that the project will result in nutrient reduction, the loan will be funded at 100%, 0% interest. Some examples of projects where you might want to look at a planning loan at 0% is if you have pending permit limits due to TMDL or enforcement type cases, or if you're in a sensitive watershed. And types of projects you're looking at would be chemical feed equipment or filtration for existing processes or new wastewater treatment plants. Design loans are also going to be funded at 0% interest if the facilities planning information supports the conclusion that the project will result in a reduction in wastewater nutrient discharges. Likewise, this could be the result of enforcement or permit conditions that you need to reduce your nutrient discharge. Construction loans are a little bit different in that we're basing the 0% interest on the percentage of nutrient removed from the discharge. We've got a couple different ways that you would do that. There's a few items we would not consider removing nutrients, and that includes processes such as disinfection that would not be eligible for 0% interest. Some of the ways you could estimate your design nutrient removal efficiency include sampling and analysis, bench or pilot tests, a mass balance, or best professional judgment. There's a lot of literature out there these days for nutrient removal type processes, so we would work with the applicants to pin down a number and let them know ahead of time what the nutrient removal efficiency would be. For a new wastewater treatment plant, major upgrades and expansions, we would apply the NRD at the bid cost of the wastewater treatment plant, and that would not include processes such as disinfection, like I mentioned before. And what you would end up with is a blended interest rate when you include processes not at 0% and processes at 0%. So you would effectively lower your interest rate even for a project that doesn't not fund it at 100%, 0% interest. Improvements to individual processes, we would apply the cost of the treatment at the of the process at the same percentage as the nutrient removal efficiency. So in this case, if you had a clarifier that was removing 15% of the phosphorus, we would apply the NRD at 15%. And for individual nutrient removal equipment, we would apply the NRD discount at 100%. So, for instance, a phosphorus removal, if you had a chemical feed system set up, and that was the only change to your process, that would be funded at 0%, 100%, 0% interest. And finally, general equipment items. This is for items that increase the overall reliability of your wastewater treatment plant process. Even if the project is not increasing the nutrient removal efficiency, if it's helping you maintain your wastewater treatment plant to continue to provide effective treatment, that would actually be funded as well at the 100%, at the overall nutrient removal efficiency. And with that, I'll turn it over to Susan, who's going to talk to you about HAB.
Thank you, John. Today I'd like to talk about two programs we have available in the drinking water program. The first is a loan program for infrastructure improvements, and the second is the grant program for cyanotoxin testing equipment. First, let's talk about the DEFA loan program. Excuse me. We have, in program year 16, we will be providing an additional $50 million in 0% interest for 20 years to address HAB issues at surface water treatment plants. This is in addition to the $50 million that we had put in place last August for the similar type projects. The projects that were submitted last fall are going to be grandfathered into our next program year. This program came about very quickly, and a lot of people weren't quite ready to proceed to award, so we're giving them a little bit more time to get their ducks in a row and get everything ready to go to get a loan award. They do have to proceed to award, though, by March 1st of next year. Otherwise, they would have to renominate the next program year. Let's talk about some of the eligible projects. Treatment processes that you would put in place to address toxins produced by the HABs would be eligible. Any projects that would implement some of the avoidance strategies, such as an interconnection with another water system or water supply. Any additional elevated storage facilities to provide more finished water storage in your distribution system, which would allow a water system to go offline while there's an event and still be able to provide adequate quantities and pressures to their customers. Another possible eligible project would be the installation of alternative sources of raw water. The nomination period is going to be open, and this is very different from our normal SRF fund. Normally, the nominations are due by March 1st of each calendar year. Because this is such a special circumstance, we are going to be accepting nominations until all of the money has been obligated. And the nomination can be found at the address that listed on the screen. Some of the projects that we've received so far include improved raw water sources. We actually have one system that's going to attempt to get completely out of the surface water treatment business and go to a groundwater source. We've received several projects that include that help enhance the treatment at the surface water treatment plants, so adding things such as ozone, PAC, potassium permanganate. Again, these have to be things that are directly tied to treating the water to either eliminate the HABs getting in the plant or to treat for the cyanotoxins so they don't make it into the distribution system. We've also received a couple projects that included emergency interconnections with other water systems. So, again, they can go offline and be served by someone else until the event has passed. And additional finished water storage will do the same thing. We want to see more finished water either stored at the plant or in elevated storage throughout the distribution system. So you have a little more wiggle room in terms of your treatment and getting things back in order before you have to issue any advisories. Next, we'd like to talk about the cyanotoxin testing equipment grant. This is available to public water systems that use a surface water source as their source of water for treatment. The equipment that must be obtained under the grant must be for the sampling and analysis of cyanotoxins. Strictly for that. It's not for things that, you know, other things would be nice to have, but it is strictly for cyanotoxin. Satellite distribution systems are not eligible for these grants. Sorry about that, but we would like to see the treatment done at the original treatment facility. There is a maximum of $30,000 per public water system. You cannot combine multiple water systems to get a larger grant. It's strictly $30,000 for each public water system. And it really provides some pretty good equipment under that level of grant. One nice thing about this grant is there's no match required for that. And one other thing I do want to mention, this is for the initial installation of testing equipment. You know, we do not pay for subsequent supplies that would be needed to maintain the testing equipment. That is up to the water system to maintain the testing equipment. Some of the things that are eligible for reimbursement, you can get a microtiter plate meter spectrophotometer. We encourage people to link these to the computer so you can do software analysis of the results. And you can it's also really nice if you can link it to a camera. That way you can take pictures, and if you're having trouble determining what types of toxins types of algae, that's also very helpful. If you've got a camera attached to it, you can take a picture, send it up to our experts here in central office, and they can help you determine whether or not it's an algae type that you should be concerned of. Also pay for the initial cost of the multi-channel pipettes, pipette tips, plate covers, etc., glassware, and the ELISA test kit for microcystin, the ADDA and other cyanotoxins. There are other test kits besides ELISA. The main thing is that we want to get the ADDA method. You can also get a microscope, and this is a pretty nice microscope. That's also, you know, connect that to the camera as well. And like I said before, you can send pictures to us, and we can help you out in identification. We're also paying for songs that have any of the following, any or all of the following sensors, the phycocyan, chlorophyll, conductivity, temperature, and pH. And any additional equipment associated with the song use, such as light persistence of sensors, handheld devices for data viewing, connector cables, if you want to hook it up to your telemetry, we'll pay for all those kind of things. And again, the installation and telemetry is covered. If you have, you mount your sonde to an intake structure or a buoy, we can cover all those things, plus a bunch more like data logger, cell modem, an enclosure, solar panel, pretty much anything you need to keep this, get this sonde up and running and make it useful to you. If you're linking it to an existing SCADA system, we can also include telemetry for that and any of the interconnecting types of equipment that you would need to make that work. And we also will pay for the buoy. If you don't have a buoy or anything structured to attach it to that works well, we'll pay for a buoy as well. Additional equipment, there's some sampling equipment you see on the screen there that's available. And a lot of training, including topics of like reservoir management, identification of algae, treatment optimization, sonde operation and calibration, training just to use the ELISA test method. That's usually part of the package when you get these test kits from the manufacturers. They will sell you the training to help your people understand how the test works and troubleshoot it and all that kind of stuff. And we do cover that as well. The applications, basically, we're going to be accepting this. We originally started out with $1 million in this fund. We've expended slightly over a half of that right now, but we're going to continue to accept applications until all the funds are depleted. So there's still quite a bit of money out there, and, you know, first come, first serve, and it's best if you can get in here while before it's getting towards the tail end. It is a reimbursement program. We don't give you the money up front. You have to purchase the equipment first and submit the receipts to us, and then we will reimburse you for the eligible items. And with that, I will throw it back to Jerry.
Okay. Thank you, Susan and John. That's a lot of good information, and I just wanted to take a minute and kind of summarize before we perhaps go to some questions. So just to kind of bring it back around to where we started. The agency announced that these three funding opportunities that we're making available, the two from the respective state revolving funds, the one from the wastewater loan program and one from the drinking water loan program, and then, of course, the new grant program feature that Susan just finished talking about for the lab and testing equipment. So I just want to make clear that for both loan programs, we made an additional amount of money available in their program year 2015, and we are going to make additional amounts of money available in the respective program year 2016. So what that means is that for the drinking water loan program, we made an initial $50 million available. That program year, 2015 program year is almost done, and the 2016 program year is going to start in July 1st. So just to kind of review, we're going to make an additional $50 million available in the drinking water loan program, in addition to the original $50 million that was available in 2015. We are grandfathering the 2015 projects over, and we'll be accepting nominations through the program year, with the caveat that the projects need to be awarded by, I believe it's March of 2016. Is that correct, Susan?
For the program year 15 loan.
For the program year 2015 loan. Okay. And then on the wastewater side, for the Water Pollution Control Loan Fund, or WPCLF, we announced an original amount for program year 2015 of $100 million that we're making available at 0%, which we're about halfway through our program year in the Water Pollution Control Loan Fund. That program year goes to the end of the calendar year, so it goes to the end of December. But at this time, we are anticipating that we are also going to make an additional amount of money available to continue to encourage communities to install treatment facilities that will reduce nutrients in the discharge. So we envision that we'll probably be making an additional $100 million available in program year 2016 for the Water Pollution Control Loan Fund. I wanted to give a couple of summary statistics for those that might be interested in just kind of seeing where we are with the award of these funds so far. When we announce a brand new program feature, there's always a bit of a lag in seeing the activity kind of being realized through loan activity. And that's the case here. But we're really starting to see both these projects on the drinking water and wastewater loan programs really starting to kind of ramp up. So just to give folks an idea of what we have awarded so far, from the wastewater loan program, the Water Pollution Control Loan Fund, so far we've awarded six projects have received the nutrient reduction discount, as we call it. And two of those were planning loans. There was one design loan and three construction loans so far that totaled about $5.2 million for those three construction loans. So all total for the Water Pollution Control Loan Fund, we've loaned out about $6.5 million of the $100 million. Now, we have quite a few projects that are slated to receive the discount in the remainder of 2015, and we're actively working and encouraging those projects to continue. For on the drinking water side, for the water supply revolving loan account, we've awarded a planning loan and a couple of construction loans so far. The one planning loan was a pretty sizable one for about $1.4 million, and then including two projects which will be awarded, actually approved by the Ohio Water Development Authority Board later on this week, that will bring the total to three construction loans, one of which was quite sizable. So on the drinking water side, the total right now looks like we're at about $32 million awarded at the 0%, or which included some 0% funds. So, again, both programs really kind of ramping up in the activity that we're seeing. With both programs, we are definitely trying to encourage more projects to come along, because this is an important feature that Ohio EPA is an important aspect that Ohio EPA is trying to deal with these harmful algal blooms and reducing nutrients in the water. So with that, I'm going to turn it back to Helen. I think we're going to take some questions.
Could collection systems in unsewered areas be eligible in 2016? These areas now drain to Graham Lake St. Mary's.
I'll take that one. This is Jerry Rao. Just to kind of review, for the current program year for the WPCLF for 2015, we did restrict the funding pretty much to treatment units at wastewater treatment plants. When we did our call for nomination, we had many requests for other types of projects. And I think that for 2016, we will be considering perhaps a wider variety of projects. And so along those lines, we would like to get comments from any of our customers, certainly those that are participating in the webinar today, about the types of projects that you think would help to contribute to this nutrient reduction effort. So So the short answer to the question is that we will consider additional projects. I think that we would like to get some feedback from our customers specifically about the why and how these projects are going to result in that nutrient reduction, because that's really what the goal of the discount is.
Great. Do you expect carryover from 2015 WPCLF funding into year 2016?
Again, this is Jerry, and yes, we intend to, for the WPCLF, we intend to carry over any remaining funds that were unobligated during 2015, as well as we plan to grandfather any projects that were on the 2015 list that were not awarded. So I think for both programs, they're kind of running parallel in that we're going to grandfather any projects that were on the existing lists over to the next program year. If any projects that were not awarded will be grandfathered over the next program year, as well as carry over any funds that were unobligated during that year.
Okay, next question is, I just want to clarify the WSRLA fund has 0% loans available for potassium permanganate addition at water plants to treat for HAB, not grant funding?
This is Susan. I'll take that one. That is correct. We will give you a loan for 0% for 20 years for chemical additions at water treatment plants that are for the purposes of treating for HAB. The grant is strictly for the cyanotoxin testing equipment.
Okay, next question. We're in the process of developing our bid form. When does DEFA establish qualifying, non-qualified work and percentages?
This is John. Typically, we would review that after you've got your bid package into us, which would be prior to loan award, we would be reviewing that. If this is project specific, you might want to talk to your DEFA team here, and they can assist you in kind of estimating what type of discount you would be looking at.
We have one more question here. Can wastewater utilities apply for grants for Sondas to monitor water quality in streams or near shore Lake Erie?
This is Susan. I can answer that one. Unfortunately, the grant is only for public water systems. It comes out of the set-aside that we get from US EPA, and it's strictly for improving the capability of public water systems. So at this time, we can't provide any grant funds to wastewater utilities.
Okay. And I think Jerry wanted to also have one more comment on the unsewered areas.
Yes, there was a previous question about if the nutrient reduction discount, the 0% funds could be used for the unsewered areas in 2016. And I wanted to point out that two things. First is that the WPCLF has in the past, the last few years, had some principal forgiveness funds that have been available and have even almost targeted unsewered areas. Even if the nutrient reduction discount is not available for the unsewered areas, there's a chance that some principal forgiveness funds could be available in 2016. Principal forgiveness is essentially like grant funds. So that would be something that I would encourage people to look at, as well as point out that many unsewered areas that we see recently qualify for the WPCLF's hardship interest rates, which are already really quite low at either 1% or 0%. Without knowing the economics of that particular situation, I couldn't tell, but obviously a loan that's awarded at a 0% hardship rate is just as good as a loan that's awarded at a 0% with a nutrient reduction discount. So we would certainly want to encourage the installation of sewers up to areas that drain into Grand Lake St. Mary's, and I think that there's probably multiple avenues of some very favorable funding from the WPCLF.
Okay.
Thank you, and this concludes our webinar. Again, if you have more questions that you think about later in the day, please feel free to contact any of the speakers. I will send out the link to the recording along with the link to the PowerPoint slides and also phone numbers and email addresses of the presenters. So thank you for attending, and have a great day.